I start. Hello, everybody, again. This is my second talk, and the topic is IoT without things, building virtual 6LoWPAN mesh networks. So in the previous talk, we heard a lot of 6LoWPAN stuff. It's IPv6 over low-power wireless personal area networks. And this talks, my talk reminds me on the yesterday talk about network in a notebook. And I think it works similarly. So 6LoWPAN subsystems, which we have in the Linux kernel, is IEEE 802.15.4, which I'm the maintainer of, and Stefan from the previous workshop. And it has mesh features, broadcast frames, and unicast frames, what you need. And we try to use net devices. So we are registered as an interface for layer 2 in the Linux kernel. So there exists also Bluetooth 4.x. And this is point-to-point only. And they use HCI devices. And I make a sad smiley here because it's already different how to create 6LoWPAN interfaces for in Linux, because for 802.15.4, we can call IP, add link, and then type 6LoWPAN. But because Bluetooth doesn't handle interface, I don't know if you ever use Bluetooth before, they have their own tools to deal with it, and this already is a difference how to create 6LoWPAN. I'm not so happy about this, but there's a new standard, Bluetooth 5.x, and this has not only point-to-point, so far I know, and I call this, that's the answer from the Bluetooth SIG to the 802.15.4, and this talk is only about 802.15.4. So situation, currently 802.15.4 6LoWPAN isn't widely used by vendors to make some products, but on the mailing list there are mostly research groups and also Wired OS. They have some little IoT operation systems for small microcontrollers, which has some 802.15.4 and 6LoWPAN stack. And the actual spec of 802.15.4 is newly 2015. They name it always something some year behind. I think the last one is 2011. And the IETF specifies a lot of RFC for 6LoWPAN in combination with this link layer. And what I mean with this link layer is the 802.15.4. So the IETF began originally to make their specification for this link layer. The community work, which I mentioned before, the Wired OS for the small microcontroller operation systems, they are a great community, and they are also active on our mailing list. They have a GitHub page, and they have also some conference, a Wired Summit, where I do also some talks. And great people, and wants to make connection between Linux and Wired OS. The Wired OS is in LGPL, And we are mostly we have mostly a quiet communication with them. Others, Sapphire, I don't know if you already heard about it. It's from the Linux Foundation. They do a different OS than Linux. It's for small microcontrollers also. And Contiki, that's also a IoT OS for small microcontrollers. And Embed, yeah, that's a stack released by ARM. But there are some parts closed, and we have not much communication work with them. So, and OpenThread, that's the open implementation of Thread, which I already mentioned in my previous talk. So the community problems with WildOS, which I have, is users detect issues with cooperation with Linux and Wild, and I get always CC'd in some GitHub discussions where the people describes his problems, and I can't really follow them because I cannot reproduce their setups, and yeah. And without the reproduce of this setup, it takes longer to fix this issue. So then we have another problem is which we have is for the development. That's many routing protocols like what we heard about Michael, and 802.15.4 has no L2 routing by the specification of IEEE. And Ripple is the answer for the lossy networks, and lossy is here a big feature because it has some self-healing mechanism to make a different routing when a node has no connection anymore to the other node. So that's why we need to manipulate the file layer. And to manipulate the file layer in the real work, like make the connection bad or make the connection broken, so it has no connection anymore to the neighbor, it's really hard in the real world. I know some beach people which have some Raspberry Pi and put foil over it to make no connection anymore, but I don't want to deal with that. And what we also want is fuzzing the stack, so for kernel crashes, so we need to check if some frame of 6LoWPAN or something can crash, can occur a kernel crash. So that's a big issue which you want to detect. And IoT application block development, so if you want to make your setup with different nodes in a mesh, and you can simply test your network in a virtual environment and do your development, or simply try it out without buying any 802.15.4 hardware. So related work, what I did for the 802.15.4 virtual stuff, this is not new. The most people, also the WildOS people and OpenThread people, they create a UDP socket over the loopback interface, and they put the 802.15.4 link layer frames on top of the UDP payload. And when you have many instances of the Wired OS or OpenSwet, they can run as ELF binary. So you have this as user space process. You can feed the application stack of each other over the loopback interface. And I think if you want to use it, it's quite complex. Because if you want to make a real mesh network, then you need to deal with bridges, with top interface, and virtual Ethernet stuff. And the most big thing is that you cannot connect Wired OS with Linux or OpenSwet together. So my solution is that we provide a file layer in the kernel that's emulating one file layer. So all applications, all 802.15.4 stacks use them to make a mesh network. And the kernel driver is fake LB. I'm not the author of this driver, but always when I describe this driver, the wireless people, with wireless I mean 802.11, they talk to me, hey, do you know HWSIM? And yes, this driver works exactly like the HWSIM simulator. Maybe I will rename the driver because I need always to explain that I know this driver and it works exactly the same. And this driver has a file connection with registers many files, virtual files, and if one file transmitter frame is checks for the virtual channel settings, so only if the channel match with the other file, it will transmit a frame. And but a big benefit is you can runtime manipulation your mesh network on this file layer. And you can also connect user space stacks like IoT OS, like what I mentioned before, Wired OS, or OpenSwet, which run as user space application process. And I usually create one file to catch all traffic. That's a typical sniffer device. So user space stacks, what I already mentioned is that they have native platforms or POSIX platforms, whatever the name is, and it's an executable ELF binary. And the file configuration, the file need to be configured over Netlink, and for frames, we use RF packet, like usually you want to run a user space stack. You need RF, you can use RF packet, raw packet, raw sockets. And it always use monitor interfaces. Monitor interfaces, you need to know you have your virtual 802.15.4 file registered, and on top of them you have your interface. And monitor interfaces, they have no MAC layer, so you can receive plain the file layer and also transmit without filtering in the kernel stack. That's the big advantage of the monitor interfaces. So what you have then in the executable binary, ELF binary, is a shell access to the Wired, or to your IoT OS, OpenSwet, or Wired. And yeah, let me show this in this example graphic. Here, what we see here on the top is on the bottom is the fake LB driver with three registered files, and these files are connected to each other, which building a mesh with two nodes, very simple. And this is the sniffer device, which I always create. So you can connect a connection for the receive handling only to the sniffer device, because a sniffer device doesn't transmit anything. So that's your perfect sniffer device, which you have. And on top of the other files, you have your normally 802.15.4 interface, which provides the 802.15.4 MAC. And on top of that, you have your 6LoWPAN interface, which is here the IPv6 interface. And then you can run the IPv6 application. And the only thing, we need to handle them in containers, because it always need to reach the MAC layer. Because if you don't run them in containers, it IPv6 makes some routing there, and then you cannot have the MAC. It will not reach the MAC layer. So one additional change is with our IoT OS. So we have all these registered files as a device class in Linux. And we have another file, file 3. And this also has a monitor interface, which has no MAC operation. And in user space, there it runs the OpenThread or Wide OS. And it uses the ARF packet stuff. So with the file is connected with the file 1 and vice versa. And you can manipulate the arrows here per runtime. But it means that all files are device class, that it means you can top the fake LB driver and use a real transceiver. On top of them, you have a monitor interface, and then you can run Wired OS or OpenThread in user space, and then you have it on your on a real hardware. But we don't recommend it, because in monitor interfaces, the hardware goes in promiscuous mode, and promiscuous mode in 802.15.4 means that they have no filtering. And it disables also some acknowledge handling. So that's why we don't recommend it, but we need to find maybe a solution for that. So how to connect files in the fake LB UI user space API and over the file index. So currently I use for that debugfs, where you can simply say add 1.2, which means add a connection between file 1 to file 2, and also the a deletion of this interface of this connection, and changing the LQE. LQE is for the link quality stuff, which is a very specific 802.15.4 value to measure the link quality. In my previous talk, I talked about link quality measurements, and I needed to make some virtual setup to manipulate this value at runtime. And yeah, that's interesting for the WireOS community on the mailing list or GitHub. You can simply provide some scripts to reproduce the setup, and then the network experts can try to figure out why the stack doesn't cooperate with together. Yeah, future work. We have in 802.15.4 some file information in a file header, and we need to provide them somehow in user space. We, over RF packet, I think we can also use the ancillary data for wakeform message to provide the link quality value, which is a value. This is per frame, and yeah, for the user space stack, we need to provide this value somehow per frame over the RF packet. So I think we can add them over the auxiliary data. In IoT OS driver, yeah, in RiotOS I did that, but I didn't make a channel setting. So that's a little to-do which I have. So it currently operates on all channels. That's a little bit stupid. It's only a to-do. And how we deal with QEMU, because Sapphire, they have no possibility to run as ELF binary in user space as broadset. They always use QEMU for their emulation. And maybe we can provide some virtual 802.15.4 hardware in QEMU and then provide a virtual 802.15.4 device there. And automated testing, that's something which I think about to connect wired OS and make some automated testing if still everything works. So I have a little demo. So what we have here is a mesh network which I create. I can show you this. Over my API, I have these the edges generated, and I think I have I have ten files, because one is the monitor. It's not the sniffer device, which is not displayed here, and we can create such net setup. And I already did some Ripple instances on each file with the unstrung implementation of from Michael Richardson. And we see here, maybe I can move this to the other space. Yeah, we see the mesh network here, and the five here stands five. That's our root, and two, it's generated a Ripple tree, which Michael already before explained here. So, how did I generate this picture is, yeah, I have also some traceroute example. It runs very slowly. I don't know why, because on my home PC it's very fast. But I can show that the edge is a simple. I delete boost connection, for example, the edge from 1 to 2, and then I have some crazy setup to generate some dot language. That's here, and I need somehow here. And you see, I delete this connection now. And I think, yeah, traceroute doesn't work anymore, because I delete the connection between 1 and 2. I add again the edge, and so it works now. So Why we need that is, one second. Ah, yeah. I didn't generate. Thanks. Yeah, and it works there. You need to know, I run this trace route from phi 1. That's my init namespace. And then it goes to 2, and then 5, and then 6, and 9. And that's what the tree also says. 1, 2, 5, and then 2, 9 is 6 and 9. And that's what the trace would say. That's something which I can imagine to make some automated testing to check some topologies, maybe some generate a random mesh, and then check if all trace routes still works. And I did delete a connection. But the benefit and the major task of Ripple is to make some repairing of this connection. So it need to go to not anymore to from 1 to 2. So it need to go to 1 to 4. But Armstrong can't deal right now with this. It's specified, but the next step is we have such setup to reproduce some connection lost. And the next step is to implement Armstrong that it can deal with the self-healing of the network. I think it doesn't support it right now because it was hard to reproduce it, but now we have this setup to make to make our development there. So it's good for us. So I have also another example, if you have time, yes, with the Wired. I just need to, yeah, they use the command ifconfig. I don't know why they name it ifconfig. I need to set up something, yes. Then I can make some ping. Yeah, they have no correction. Yeah, and we see the current interface is they have this address, the one this address is from the init namespace. I can show you this, and I did some connection between the phi and this low-pan interface. So we can also connect Wired OS with a Linux stack and also OpenThread. Or if you want, you can only use Wired OS or only use OpenThread or make OpenThread and Wired OS. And yes. Yeah, I think yeah, that was it. Any questions?
No. Questions for Alex? So I got a question. Since we're mad. Can you also use proprietary IoT stacks and integrating this, like you put them in a, like Arm Embed, I think you said has some proprietary stuff.
So they, I think they provide no binaries for.
There's no binaries for.
For only for Arm.
They claim it's open source.
I think if they have some platform to run as ELF binary in user space and offers to the driver interface inside them. Then you only need to connect to the ELF packet, and then you can connect.
But this is where also QEMU could be useful, right? If you could put QEMU into ARM architecture.
Maybe. Yeah. QEMU, then you can run it. And if they have driver support for the transceiver, then it might also be working.
Okay. So thanks. Let's give a warm applause to